Hi, I'm Sarah Morris.
And I'm Vicki Emerson.
And you're listening to 103.5 FM.
WLSP LP, Sun Prairie, Wisconsin.
You're trying my shoes on for a change.
Hello, and welcome to another edition of the Schmozcast. I'm Chandler here in the 103.5 The Sun Community Radio Station with Anthony and Andre. Fellas, how are we doing this evening?
I'm listening to No Doubt Sunday morning. I'm feeling great.
It just feels like a Sunday morning.
It feels like a Sunday morning.
Andre?
I'm doing great as well.
Excellent, excellent.
He's all over social media right now.
All over the place with it. Check us out at the Schmozcast. This week we're going to be talking about the train wreck of a show that was Monday Night Raw, including the Eye of the Storm, which was the Bobby Lashley's sister segment.
Attractive. Super attractive.
I thought that was
great
the best segment
ladies.
Of the night.
Great looking ladies.
Just kidding, by the way. That was horrid.
Also, we're going to be talking about...
Not a nice name to talk about his sisters that way.
Oh, jeez.
Horrid? Sorry. Horrid.
With a
horrid.
D.
Horrid. There's a D.
Yes.
Yeah.
Also, we'll talk about the next night, last night, Smackdown, just a fantastic show, and things that are going on deal-wise with both shows, Raw and Smackdown. To start off with, there's a new deal that will be in place in 2019. Smackdown will most likely be moving to Fridays and will be on the Fox network. We don't know quite yet if it's going to be actual Fox or if it'll be FS1, Fox Sports. But yeah, it'll be moving to Raw, and I'm pretty sure, or I'm sorry, moving to SmackDown will be moving to Fox. And is Raw staying with USA?
That was reported last week that USA will be keeping Monday Night Raw. That was a bit of a surprise. But then this sort of is the idea was keeping Raw with on Monday nights with USA, and then to land another deal with the Fox network, whether it be Fox Sports or just your standard Fox. So Raw will stay on USA, and then, yeah.
Got it. And yeah, and also the deal for Fox with SmackDown was a $1 billion deal. So, I mean, you know, Vince McMahon, he's just rolling in the dough. And I think after the episode of Raw this past week, SmackDown and Fox, in Fox's eye, SmackDown is smelling like roses because they absolutely made the right call with going with Raw and SmackDown instead of Raw because of how terrible Monday Night Raw was this week.
Yeah, it was atrocious. There was maybe one or two good things that I enjoyed from the show, but other than that, man, it was a chore to watch. That Lashley segment was. It was cringeworthy. It was very uncomfortable. It didn't do anybody any favors. Least so WWE made it put WWE didn't. I don't know. It seems like they take two steps forward, one step back. I mean, whatever. It's not the end of the world, but it was. I just don't understand how it left the writing room floor. Who? Obviously, we know who okayed it in the end.
Who?
We know who okayed it in the end, but it's like. Hopefully people were telling him, Vince, this is not a good idea. But I don't know. I don't know what else to say.
It really was awful. We do have a caller, so we're gonna take that call right now, and God only knows what's about to happen. Hello, caller? Hello, caller, you're on the air.
Hey! Wrestling.
Yeah, wrestling. Great. Awesome. We're off to a great start. Our caller not only is aware of the topic of our show, but also the theme of all of our shows.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what good callers do. Fans know what they are fans of.
That's right.
I am fans of wrestling.
That's right. Sounds like we have Matthew Jeffco on the phone. This is a surprise phone call. Matthew, thank you so much for being with us. Did you want to get in talking about... WWE SmackDown moving to Friday nights?
No, but I do want to talk about the Blake Bortles Facts Twitter handle holding up a sign on...
This is very important stuff. Wrong. I did see this. Wrong. I did see this. Yeah. So, yeah, I'm going to let you go ahead and tell the story.
Okay. Well, I love Blake Bortles Facts. I think it's a great Twitter account. It makes me laugh every time I read about how Blake Bortles, unlike Matthew Stafford, has never lost such and such, or Blake Bortles has never thrown an interception on Mars, or, you know, silly sort of things that Blake Bortles has never done. Blake Bortles has never... Or I think so. The sign that this particular person held up in Jacksonville on Monday night was Blake Bortles is undefeated in WWE.
And, this is true. This is a fact. These are just the facts.
Yeah. And he, it's exactly right. It's a fact. And he kept appearing. And so security told him that if he didn't put down a sign, he was going to have to leave. But he kept tweeting about how funny that was. And I thought it was great because I watched it in real time as I was watching the NBA. And that was my connection to wrestling this week.
That's a big deal, Matthew, because I have a feeling you're not a regular wrestling watcher. But if Twitter and Blake pretend Blake Bortles' Twitter account can can get you involved in wrestling in one way, shape, or form, I think that's kind of a nice thing. So thank you for being a part of the machine.
Yeah, I loved every second of the wrestling I wasn't watching, but watching. Twitter. It was delightful.
Is there a crying baby in the background?
Yeah, she is, you know, gosh. I just found a baby turtle, and we bought a terrarium, put the little baby turtle in it, and now the baby's upset. My wife went to go get ice cream, because she's, like just needs sugar. And I needed to call you to tell you that I was going to have to leave early tomorrow, because my boss scheduled me earlier than she was supposed to.
And this is what's happened to our show. Great. So, okay, turtles and professional wrestling. Are you familiar with the toxic turtles, similar to the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, but a little bit different because of copyright along with gimmick infringement?
Yeah, I think I am. Maybe I had one of their toys, I feel like. Is that possible? Were they popular 25 years ago?
That is possible, but these toxic turtles were a take off of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, but they were used in wrestling so as not to... They had to change the name slightly. Here's the thing, though, Matthew. If one of these turtles, the toxic turtles who were professional wrestlers, got, you know, if there was a move that left them on their back, they actually couldn't turn over. They had to get help from a different turtle, one of the other turtles, to get back upright and wrestling into the match.
Wait a minute, but you got a tag. You can't just have somebody sliding in on the ring and, like, flipping you out of your turtle shell. You need a tag.
Snapping at your nether regions?
Yeah.
Snap suplex?
Tell me more. This is great.
It didn't last long because, I guess, even though the world was enamored with Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Wrestling Turtles and the Toxic Turtles did not do quite the same in terms of garnering entertainment or dollars.
Maybe they kept losing to Legion of Doom.
That was another issue, yes.
You know what? I bet you the Bushwhack twins probably just turned them into turtle soup. That's probably the problem.
Turtle soup and the Bushwhack twins. I believe you're referencing the Bushwhackers, but man, you are off to a hot start right now. I am impressed with your wrestling knowledge coming out of nowhere while dealing with a new terrarium and a crying child.
Yeah. Well, she's all right now. She's just all wet. Her, like, wet, soggy romper is leaking in on my nice shirt.
A baby romper.
Yeah, baby romper.
Baby rompers.
You know, they're really awful because you have to take them off from the top. No different than, like, every, like, beautiful woman you see wearing a jumper or a romper. Like, when she goes to take a dump in the bathroom, she has to put that around her ankles and sit on the toilet naked in public. And so when you have a baby romper, the baby's doing the same thing. She's like kicking around all naked, and you gotta, like, I don't know. It's not as easy as a onesie where you can sort of like contain their limbs all within fabric. Remove the diaper and then just zip it up quickly again.
Nothing. You know what I'm talking about. Yeah. Although I do know what you're talking about, nothing I have to say is appropriate for community radio. So if they want to hear more, I guess they're gonna have to tune in at 7 a.m. tomorrow because we'll probably finish.
Oh, this is what we'll talk about. And we're gonna play a bunch of great music. But I'm gonna have to leave a little early. I just wanted to call you.
Thank you so much for calling our live program to tell us this. This is great.
Oh, you get realness here.
Yeah, there's great.
No Faker stage. That's what's so great about the Schmozcast.
That's right. And Matthew, if you're interested in listening to more of the Schmozcast, you can actually subscribe to our YouTube channel, the Schmozcast Men in Tights on YouTube. You should probably check that out.
You should cut this segment out, though. I don't want to
We'll see. This might be our highest rated segment since the show started, or since the last time you called and ruined our show.
Oh, well, thank you. I'm 2 for 2. I take great pride in my record.
Yes.
Somebody's going to have to come and get this intercontinental belt from me. What?
Wow. All right. Rack him. He's out. That's great. Well, that was Matthew Jeffco. He hosts a show with me on Thursday mornings at 7 a.m. right here on 103.5 The Sun. That was not planned.
And that's his kid, right?
That was his kid.
So to tie it into wrestling, is he a new father or?
It's a 1-year-old baby, but he has a 10-year-old from a previous relationship.
Okay. So then it doesn't tie into the fact that WWE has a few new fathers here with Miz, Daniel Bryan, and Mike Kanellis, but whatever.
You could, I mean, somewhat, but yeah, I don't know where that fits in.
I don't know. I was just trying to make it relevant.
Oh God, good. Yeah, good luck.
Interesting. Segment.
Awesome. Wow.
Some good references, though.
I was surprised at his wealth of knowledge.
Did you know that the Bushwhackers, and I just heard this somewhere, I can't remember which podcast I heard it on, but they used to, right before they'd go out, they used to like chew on garlic and just other really nasty stuff before they go out and lick someone, just so that it was really disgusting. I just heard that, and then when he said Bushwhackers, that reminded me of that, so I figured I'd have to share that bit of random knowledge. It was probably one of the Conrad Thompson podcasts. I'm almost 99.9% sure that's where I heard that from.
Well, speaking of bushwhacking, I think getting poison ivy would have been better than that phone call. So, but here we are hosting wrestling. Okay, back to SmackDown, going to Friday nights, or possibly on Friday nights. It sounds like that's the idea now with the new big deal with Fox.
As far as what I've read and seen around so far, yes. But you guys brought up that they're also possibly going to be looking at SmackDown as the A show. Is that because of this deal? We were discussing this earlier, but I hadn't heard anything about that at all. And is that just kind of a rumor, or is that like going forward once they make the switch, they're going to be looking at SmackDown as the A show?
That was just me merely hoping the fact that $1 billion was thrown at it, that it might be taken more seriously, more like the A show, because that's a lot of money, and we know how Vince McMahon feels about money. I know that Raw is his baby, and that's something that he's had since 93, and that's when it came down to it, that's ultimately his golden goose. But maybe that $1 billion deal changes things, and with it being on Fox, it's a lot different than when it was on UPN. I think this is a big deal, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what happens in 2019 when the move happens, whether or not they change nights, but to see how it's booked, and even to see how it's booked from here on out until 2019.
I think what channel of Fox this goes to, it will be very telling as to whether or not SmackDown becomes the A show. Right now, Fox Sports, the channel Fox Sports, not your just standard Fox, which is available just via antenna, but Fox Sports is only available in about 80 to 85 million homes, whereas Fox, the channel that you can get once again through the antenna, is available in 97% of homes in the United States. So that's a big deal. If you do go to Fox, the standard channel, and go to Friday nights, then I think, yes, that SmackDown becomes the A show. However, if it goes to just Fox Sports, only being in 80 million homes compared to, you know, 320, 330 homes in the United States, then I think that that market of fans, the amount of fans that actually have Fox Sports with Fox Sports, is a lot less than the people who have USA Network. So if it goes to Fox Sports, I think it continues to be the B show. If it goes to actual Fox, because it's in almost every home in the United States, then it does become the A show on Friday nights. The Friday night thing is weird. I think that my personal history with watching SmackDown, that if it's on Thursdays, that's when I'm most likely to watch. That's what it started out on. That's what it's gone to a few times over the years. We're getting close to 20 years now of SmackDown. I think near the August of next year of 2019 will be the 20-year anniversary of SmackDown. I've always had much better continuous history watching SmackDown when it's on Thursdays and not Fridays. I mean, everyone has so much stuff going on Fridays already. Tuesday's an okay night, getting your wrestling like back-to-back with Monday Night Raw and Tuesday Night SmackDown, but Thursday night is ideal for me. But in terms of SmackDown being the A show, if they go to Fox and not Fox Sports, then I think that does make them the A show because so many more homes in the United States, and I mean, anyone outside the States are going to get it one way or another anyway. But in terms of inside the United States, if they go to Fox and people can just get it on an antenna and don't even have to pay for cable, that really is a huge deal. And I think that does make it the A show because that's really the first time since they had programming on Saturday nights back in the, like, when they took the place of Saturday Night Live, when Saturday Night Live wasn't a thing for a couple years. Like, it's been a while since they've had a continuous program on one of the major four. I know UPN could be considered when they were, you know, you have NBC, which WWE was on, Fox, which they will be on now, once again, Antenna or Fox Sports, or NBC and ABC, or CBS, sorry, I got to throw that one in there. UPN also was available through just Antenna, but this is like, it being when it was on NBC back in the day during the like Dick Ebersol era, that's a lot bigger deal than when SmackDown was on UPN, which was via Antenna, but is still like the kind of bastard child of the of those like.
Well, I mean, it was
five.
That's when it debuted. That's when it started.
It started on UPN.
It was a project.
Shasta McNasty, baby.
Yes. Oh my goodness, Shasta McNasty, taking it back. But yeah, no, it was. I wanted to bring that up. The fact that back in the day, you had Saturday night's main event on network television, and it just I agree with everything that you're saying, just to echo the fact that main event now is a pre-recorded show that like they do maybe I'd say maybe two or three times out of a month they'll mm-hmm. do a main event before Monday Night Raw. And then they'll show it on the network. But Saturday night's main event back when it came out, that was a really big deal. They had if you can go back on the network and watch, they have some big time matchups on those. And it just makes all the sense in the world that if they do put it on just regular Fox, not Fox Sports, it would make all the sense in the world for it to be looked at as the A show because of the fact that anyone if you have basically if you have a TV, you're able to watch it. You don't need to have cable, you don't need an online subscription, anything like that. If you have a television, you will be able to watch WWE programming on live TV, and that's huge.
So does that mean that hopefully once a star gets really, really, really big in SmackDown, they won't get poached and moved to Raw as soon as they become hot commodity? Will that stop happening with Fox?
Or
Is it going to go the other way around now, maybe? Is SmackDown going to poach the Raw talent, or is it just going to be treated as equal shows? I don't know. I'm interested to see how it goes. I'm excited. I'm excited to see what they do.
Do you guys think that? So it supposedly has been reported. You guys told me this before the show that SmackDown would move to 3 hours. Then, how do you think that changes things? Will they kind of absorb 205 Live to make up for that? Already, we haven't seen 205 Live wrestlers on Monday Night Raw, which is supposedly their show, since at least a month before WrestleMania, which was over a month ago. And since 205 Live is on right after SmackDown, you know that they're basically traveling together anyway, or that seems like the likely thing. So if SmackDown Live were to absorb the 205 Live, would that help them get that extra hour? Since this is the show that's more about in-ring product anyway, and Triple H has kind of taken over as his second baby other than NXT, does that bode well for getting a third hour if that includes the 205 Live roster, since we really haven't seen them on Raw since maybe even, I don't know, late February, early March at the latest?
I would hope so, but it makes sense to have 205 Live become a part of SmackDown for that third hour. A few reasons in the pro column, I would say, is just to avoid having terrible segments like pretty much all of Raw. I know I keep harping on it, but we'll get to that in a second. But to avoid situations like that, just, you know, time filling type of stuff, you can stick to in-ring competition. But also at the same time, I wouldn't want the cruiserweights to kind of get lost in the shuffle how they did on Raw. I want them, like, I like the fact that they have 205 Live, but I don't know. I would hope that if they don't have 205 Live as their own dedicated show, that they're taking a lot more serious, and they are still kind of their own entity, but within SmackDown, within the 3 hours of SmackDown, because I guess you could kind of get away with having the Cruiserweights kind of be an afterthought on Monday Night Raw when the next night they have their own hour-long show. Mm-hmm. But if they don't have that dedicated show and they become a part of SmackDown and that's how you fill the 3 hours, they need to make sure that they don't make them a lesser or an afterthought.
I honestly think that SmackDown's roster is big enough for them to fill 3 hours.
And I think that as well.
Without getting the Cruiserweights involved and keeping the Cruiserweights separate. A separate show, because like you said, they can get lost in the shuffle pretty easily, which they did on Raw, and they always felt separate on Raw. It never flowed, and I don't want to see that on a 3-hour SmackDown. I was hesitant to want SmackDown to go 3 hours, but if it does, that's not necessarily a bad thing, because they have a deep enough roster and enough things going on that they can fill 3 hours, and they don't have to use filler. Raw doesn't need to do half of the filler nonsense that they do. I don't understand it, because there's plenty of things that they can... Ah, whatever. I'm getting off on a tangent. We'll get on the Lashley stuff when we get to that. But I think 3 hours would work on SmackDown as long as they don't... As long... They have enough deep enough roster. There's guys that don't get used every week. And it's kind of weird, because there was... Who did not show up last week, or who was barely...
On Raw or SmackDown?
On both, actually.
On Raw, I did not see Bray Wyatt or Matt Hardy on SmackDown. On Raw. And I obviously, you know, the 205 Live roster, there's plenty of people. Okay, so when the 205... When it was decided that 205 Live was going to be a show, the Cruiserweights are going to come to Raw. They have 3 hours. This will help them. You know, we thought this will help them figure that out. And that apparently wasn't the case. They did get lost in the shuffle still. They weren't. It wasn't important. The purple ropes, the new commentators, nothing helped. Whereas I think this will be different when you're adding an hour and filling in. Because right now 205 Live is an average 2, maybe 3 matches, but usually just 2. And so if you use that plus then filler time or an extended Miz TV, an extended New Day segment, an extended Daniel Bryan promo, whatever it might be, I think you can actually fit this in really well. And maybe being Friday nights, when I don't know if people are going to pay as much attention, but it could still be on as a background thing, maybe in a lot of whatever bars or living rooms or whatever parties that it might be. I think that this will be better for 205 Live than its original iteration on Monday Night Raw. I think that you give them 2 more matches and you make other things a little bit longer. It's Friday nights, 3 hours. It won't seem quite as long and daunting as, wow, I just spent, you know, my Monday nights 3 hours and 15 minutes watching this, and I don't feel that satisfied about it. I do think Friday nights will help that a little bit, and if you add the Cruiserweights in. And then also, hopefully, one of my hopes is that the Cruiserweight division is not kind of stuck in only facing each other, that maybe we get to see some of these other guys. Like, man, I'd love to see Daniel Bryan versus Cedric Alexander or all sorts of stuff. I think there's more fun potential matchups, or maybe Samoa Joe gets into a small rivalry for a couple weeks with, like, Grand Metalik, or, you know, someone who just pissed him off randomly backstage, and nothing that's going to get to a pay-per-view, but similar to what we wanted out of, like, Jericho and Goldberg back in the day. Like, there's still fun things that you could do. Like, can you imagine how much fun Rusev could be going up against some of the Cruiserweights? I think that would actually be a lot of fun. Or Big E, or Xavier Woods now gets thrown into the Cruiserweight division, or a Kofi Kingston. So I think there are cool aspects of the possibilities. I don't know if that any of them are going to come to fruition, but with them making SmackDown an hour longer and adding the Cruiserweights, I think that's a better scenario than when they already had 3 hours of Raw basically set, even though it was boring a lot of the times, and the same old 6-man tag matches and 2 long promos to start or whatever. That this will be much better for the Cruiserweight division.
Yeah, I think it makes more sense just to add them to SmackDown if it's going to go to 3 hours, which seems to be the case. Also, with this deal, for pretty much for the foreseeable future, all the pay-per-views, which are, you know, for the rest of the year from here on out, as far as we know, because this could change by 2019. But for the rest of this year, the pay-per-views are going to be four hours long because of the switch to SmackDown being 3 hours. And then you have the big five pay-per-views, which it does include now Money in the Bank, Royal Rumble, Survivor Series, SummerSlam, and WrestleMania. Those are we're looking probably at about 5+ hours at least, I would say, for those. I don't know. It's getting to, for me personally, I will sit there and I'll watch the whole thing, but man, that's I feel like that's kind of asking a lot. I think we have differing opinions on this, but I feel that if you have alternating months of pay-per-views exclusive to Raw and SmackDown, keep them at 3 hours, and then have the big four that I mentioned, have those be 4 hours. I think that that's better than having regularly 4 hour pay-per-views and then 5 hours or possibly longer, including pre-show for the big five.
I agree with everything you said, except one thing. WrestleMania should be 5 hours. Not seven like it is, but it should be five. And the other big four besides WrestleMania, four. And then
I would be fine with that.
Other than that, I completely WrestleMania. Agree. Yeah. I think if you keep them, I understand that having single branded pay-per-views didn't work, but I think that's because it was every single month. If you alternate and you give each show 2 months to build,
exactly,
I think that makes a world of difference. You get breathing room and storylines. You can set things up, and you can get people invested. When they invest time and good storytelling and good interactions between heels and baby faces and tweeners and all that stuff, then the fans get invested one way or another. They want to either see someone win or see someone lose. And it feels like everything's too quick. There are occasional slow burn storylines, but everything seems to happen really, really quick nowadays in WWE, which is kind of why I like the Matt Hardy, Bray Wyatt thing, because that's been really kind of a slow burn thing. But other than that, things seem to go really, really quick. And I think 2 months in between each pay-per-view would help. It would help in the same sense that it helps NXT. I mean, there's a lot more than just that helps NXT. But when you have several months in between takeovers, it makes takeovers that much more important and the build to it that much more important as well.
And then that gives you room for what Froney mentioned earlier. You say you have the Cruiserweights become a part of SmackDown, and you have matchups that aren't going to even have a pay-per-view blow off, but they're just kind of something to keep things going for a week or two. That gives you more space for that, and then you can still also have time to put someone like a Rusev into a rivalry or a situation where the match does culminate at a pay-per-view. Froney, what would your opinion be, or your thoughts on these kinds of things?
Okay, so I have some agreements and some disagreements. So some agreements would be that, let's see. Okay, so there needs to be more time in between pay-per-views. Yes, but they did get rid of Great Balls of Fire and potentially Roadblock, so there are two less pay-per-views. And I get the idea of wanting to go alternating months because you're giving time for each show to build for each other. Until 2019, until there actually is, because right now you have both of your major shows, Raw and SmackDown, are on the same network. It's USA. So I think especially now, doing dual-branded pay-per-views does make sense. In January of next year, whenever the deal starts to take place, I might change that a little bit because you might want your Fox guys on SmackDown to not ever really mingle outside of those 4 or 5 times a year. Right now, though, I think dual-branded pay-per-views is the way to go, and I think 4-hour pay-per-views is the way to go, and part of it I'll use Andre's logic. Yes, there are. It's fewer and far between that you get a NXT takeover, but your weekly NXT takeover or your weekly NXT show is an hour long. NXT takeovers are 2.5 to 3 hours long. I think that the pay-per-views will be better and will benefit from the storytelling that we all want, right? By getting the longer blow-off matches, by getting a bigger story there, by having these matches not just be a quick 8 minutes and then and important intros that take too long. I think you actually get to stretch these out a little bit more. I think it makes it more important that it's a little bit longer. I think your bigger events should be longer. I think that you get more out of not just your main event, as we would all hope, but also the first match or the women's match that, I mean, now we do see women getting in the main event picture, but that wasn't always the case. But I think that this helps even some like mid-level women's matches get a bigger amount of time. I think 4-hour pay-per-views really is the way to go. And when the story means the most, even if it is a Backlash or a No Mercy or, you know, not one of the big five pay-per-views, I do want to see those be longer. Certainly not a seven-hour WrestleMania. I think you do go to, you maybe push for five for the big five, or you stick at four for the big four or outside of Mania, which would be five, which I'm fine with. But I think to make special events seem like special events, I think you do go 4 hours. I have no problem with that, and I think that helps the storytelling overall in giving them more time to especially when it's the big blow-off. I think that's so much more important to have the ability to tell the story you wanted to tell and not be constricted for time. And ultimately, I think that four-hour pay-per-views right now is a good thing. So I'm on board for this. And I think you do this until we see SmackDown on Fox, and then we take a step back and decide then. If you're WWE, and then you decide then, okay, since this one's USA and this is Fox, let's just not even keep them together out of these four brands or these pay-per-views that were previously agreed upon.
I can understand that. I agree with that somewhat. One of my key issues with it's not so much the length. 4 hours, I'm still going to watch it, of course. To me, it's every pay-per-view being dual-branded. I understand the reasoning behind it, but from a kayfabe storyline sense, I don't like it being every single month that the rosters come together, because when this whole brand separation started, Vince McMahon was like, I want it to be competition at your throats. And it's like there's too much co-mingling if it happens every month. I mean, we have to still wait and see. I'm going to revisit this. Maybe they do a good job of keeping them separate even on the same pay-per-view, but I just think that having them come together is a special thing that should happen four or five times a year at the big five. And as you said, maybe that changes in January when SmackDown moves, but storyline-wise, it should still be separate because they should still be competing. There's too much intermingling. Shane being backstage to get Roman over is another thing that really irked me. Seeing ads for each other's, back when it was single brand of pay-per-view, seeing ad for each other's pay-per-views on the opposite show bothered me. Nowadays, seeing ads for Raw and SmackDown and vice versa bother me, but I understand that a little bit more because it's USA Network. You can kayfabe say, well, it's USA Network advertising their shows. I hope when the brand split, or when the, not the brand split, the brand split already here. I hope when SmackDown moves to the new network, Fox, that kind of becomes more, the wall between each show becomes bigger and there's more separation, because I just enjoy the having those. I just enjoy seeing two rosters separate, and then when they come together for big matches and stuff like that, it seems more important. Like they used to do back in the day, back in the early WrestleMania 20, 21, 22 back then. Shawn Michaels versus Kurt Angle. That was a Raw and SmackDown superstars that they had to creatively get together, and they did that through the Royal Rumble and through one of those big four. So I've always, maybe for it's in a more nostalgia thing, but I totally see all your points and can understand that from a business aspect.
Okay, let's analyze this from a little bit of a different, from like a specific pay-per-view point of view. Let's go with Survivor Series this most recent year, which seemed just very forced. All of a sudden, you know, these two different brands which never really commingle are all of a sudden rivalries, and guys who are fighting each other on SmackDown all of a sudden are brothers in arms and taking on Monday Night Raw, and gosh darn it, we're doing it for Shane McMahon and Daniel Bryan. I think that these Survivor Series rivalries will actually mean a lot more, and this is just from one pay-per-view that I'm thinking about here, just because it's the main one where they'll face off. It'll mean a lot more if, like, you know, they saw them on the previous pay-per-view, or they got into it, or there was this backstage incident, or that,
where you could plant the seed at the previous pay-per-view.
Or that Monday Night Raw had the last three main event pay-per-views. Their matches went on last, whereas the SmackDown guys didn't. And they've commingled.
Yeah.
So I think that, and I'm, like I said, we're putting it like in the Survivor Series vacuum, and I know that's one pay-per-view out of 12 to 14 in a year, but I think that you can actually build for Survivor Series better in this way, having guys that, you know, will see each other once a month in that regard, as opposed to the, hey, we were rivals, but all of a sudden we're going to go after the red brand just because we wear blue.
I feel you there, but in the early mid-2000s, they were able to do it. There's no reason why they can't do it again. Their talent roster today probably stacks up just as good, if not better, to the talent roster they had back then. But Oh, it's an interesting conversation, and I see and understand a lot of your points, and that does make a lot of sense.
That definitely makes it work out more. That's not something that I considered, but that really makes things work out more in my eyes, definitely. I like that take on it.
And I don't hate the concept. I'm still going to watch it. I'm still a fan, of course. It's not like it's not a Roman Reigns type of situation for me where it's like, oh my gosh, dual brand of pay-per-view. Yeah. No, it's like, okay, I can deal with it. I can live with it, and we'll wait and see how they pan out.
Yes, we will. Kind of switching gears, I want to quick talk about before time runs out here, talk about Raw and SmackDown this past weekend, just the contrast between the two shows, kind of run down what happened on both shows and why SmackDown was A, just standalone, a fantastic episode of SmackDown this week, but B, also why it was so much better than anything Raw did this week, including the train wreck of a segment. So let's talk about SmackDown first. Just to run it down quick, you had the show started off with the New Day on Miz TV, and Miz was trying to get the answer out of New Day of which of the three would be going into the Money in the Bank ladder match, because last week it was Woods and Big E versus The Bar, and the team that won got to pick one of their teammates to go on to the Money in the Bank match. So the Miz started off this episode of SmackDown trying to get that out of the New Day, and they kind of danced around the subject, ended up throwing pancakes in his face.
They didn't tell him
who.
And then when he rephrases question to which,
which?
I love that part. That whole segment was great. But
it was a fantastic segment. All four men just so good on the microphone and have great chemistry. During the segment, Big E ends up challenging the Miz to a match, and the Miz is like, "No, that's not going to happen tonight." Goes back to backstage in gorilla position, kind of gets stopped by Paige and says, no, that is going to happen. So the first matchup of the night is the Miz versus Big E, where Miz ends up getting the victory. Next up, we have Lana defeating Billie Kay in her first ever singles victory in WWE, on TV at least. And Lana qualifies for the Money in the Bank, women's Money in the Bank ladder match.
How about Aiden English in that match? He killed it. He got the crowd chanting Lana Day. It was a lot of fun. I really liked it.
Absolutely. That was awesome. Lana's over now. Lana's, you could make the argument she's just as over as Rusev now because of Aiden English's work. So definitely kudos to him. Andrade Cien almost destroyed another local competitor. That back elbow, though. Oh, if you haven't seen it, look it up. Shinsuke Nakamura and AJ kind of had a face-to-face where it seemed like Shinsuke was going to tell AJ what the stipulation of the match would be. He first said there would be a pillow fight, and then a kind of brawl ensued. Shinsuke ends up knocking AJ out with a Kinshasa, counts to 10, grabs a mic, and says last man standing match. So at Money in the Bank, it will be a last man standing match for the WWE title. Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson defeated the Usos to become the number one contenders and will be getting a tag team title shot. We got the Good Brothers against the Bludgeon Brothers at Money in the Bank, which this card is shaping up. I'm really looking forward to Money in the Bank.
Poor Good Brothers, though.
Yeah, they're going to get bludgeoned, unfortunately. Naomi defeated Sonya Deville to qualify for the Women's Money in the Bank ladder match. And in the main event, first ever matchup, Daniel Bryan defeats Jeff Hardy. And that was a second opportunity match for qualifying for the Money in the Bank because Big Cass was not cleared to wrestle. They're saying kayfabe that it was the heel hook that Daniel Bryan put in on him last week, but really overseas at a house show, he was in a match and re-injured his knee, tweaked it a little bit. So
I hear that might be a work, so you know.
The
injury? Because I've heard from multiple sources that they – not from multiple sources. I've seen from multiple people on Twitter that were overseas saying that they did that spot at more than one house show.
Okay.
But that's just people talking on Twitter. Okay. That's no confirmed source or anything like that.
So they were just working that into the fact that now this week they're saying that the reason is the heel hook from last week, which makes sense. But so now after that main event, which was a fantastic match, we will have Daniel Bryan going against Rusev in next week. And the winner of that takes the last spot in the Men's Money in the Bank ladder match. Just top to bottom, a fantastic show. It started off, I was doubled over laughing and just thoroughly entertained by the New Day and Miz on Miz TV. And then it ended with what could be looked at, you know, I honestly think that could be a match of the year candidate. It was that good. A
couple highlights of the show, one of them being Kofi running around the ring.
Oh my god.
Jumping,
oh my god,
off of was it Sheamus's Cesaro shoulder. Yeah. And clotheslining Sheamus.
That was awesome. Unreal. Oh man. That was
a moment.
That was so great. And like I just everything about SmackDown was head and shoulders better than Raw. Frony, did you watch SmackDown?
I did not get to see SmackDown. I did watch Monday Night Raw. I will say just about the Kofi spot, and I haven't seen it yet, but it's hard to think of someone who would have a better just clip highlight video when their career is all said and done. And you know, there's plenty of other guys that I would say are better wrestlers or whatever, and I'm not taking anything away from Kofi. He is awesome. I don't put him potentially in the main event picture the way I know you guys have in the past, just based on conversations that we've had about the New Day and where, you know, their projections are. But it's hard to think of someone who would actually have a better, just like a YouTube highlight clip, than what Kofi Kingston's going to end up with when he does ultimately decide to hang up the boots. I don't know. So, I don't know who's really gonna have the rival to that.
Two names.
Okay.
Rey Mysterio and Rob Van Dam.
Okay, RVD outside is the one of, that came to my name. Came to my head, but I didn't think
outside, of those two. I mean, we're just talking like flashy, crazy, awesome, high flying type of
fun things that you've never really not seen before. And Jeff Hardy's got to be in the conversation as
not
well.
Not necessarily, you know, outstanding technical or chain wrestling,
right.
Or a crazy chair shot or something. We're talking just absolutely insanely ridiculous. How does your body move that sort of way? Type of highlight reel.
And the three guys you mentioned, RVD, Rey Mysterio, and Jeff Hardy, I mean, they all deserve to be right up there. But I will just say, in terms of like once in a lifetime kind of spot, I think that Kofi is going to have the most ones like, oh, I've never seen anything like that. Or, oh, based on the rules in this match, I didn't think that was possible. I think that he'll have the most, but all the three or four guys that we mentioned there are going to be in that conversation.
Where Kofi has those three beat is his Rumble.
Without a doubt.
Elimination avoiding sequences. I don't know how you want to call it, but all those times that he avoided elimination at Rumble on top of the Money in the Bank and the ladder match moments that he's had, all that combined with everything else, I think that puts him above the other names that we talked about. As far as if you're talking straight highlight reel, mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I can't wait to see one of his highlight reels when he retires or when he gets inducted into the Hall of Fame. That's going to be cool.
And one other thing, I'll just separate him from those other three, even though, once again, those three are awesome. And
That's good company to be in.
Yeah, and I think anyone that we've talked about would be in my top 25 to 30 wrestlers ever. I don't put Kofi in there, but I still love and respect him and what an entertainer he's become. And him in the New Day has been his best stuff by far. But in terms of, okay, so all those guys have great spots, but Kofi is more, oh, okay, in this match, these are the rules. So it makes sense for me to do this. And a lot of that goes along with the avoiding, you know, the evasive Royal Rumble tricks or whatever to get out of an elimination. But he just does a really good job, like, I think, thinking about it and, okay, if this is going to happen and these are the rules of the match, why I would do this. And kind of follows that. And I think that's what I might put him ahead of the other guys, even though, like I said, that's a Hall of Fame cast of characters right there. And in terms of high flyers, you could probably get away with that being a Mount Rushmore of sorts of those guys in terms of WWE Hall of Fame or Mount Rushmore of high flyers.
I wouldn't be opposed to saying that would be WWE's Mount Rushmore of high flyers.
And
all
four of those guys have been around for so long too, and had, you know, lengthy stays at the top. Not guys who were just considered high flyers for their time, or were high flyers for a year or two, or didn't last that long, or didn't get the push, or whatever. Like, I think that you couldn't go wrong with picking those four. I'm sure there's some other guys we could throw in there as well, but that's really not a bad four to start the conversation with. Yeah,
definitely. Maybe we should do an episode about that.
You know what? That's you think next week? Topic. I mean, end of May, we get in there with
talk about some high flyers.
Yeah.
Including 205 Live guys?
Sure.
Yeah.
Sure.
I would do a little
high flyer episode. Yeah. I think that'd be fun.
That would be.
I'm definitely down.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah, brother. Tell that kid to put 205 Live on the television, brother.
Give me another fantasy factory, brother. All right. So all of you see just all this great conversation we're having just spawning from SmackDown Live.
That's right.
Let's flip that coin
and talk
about Monday Night Raw and just the tragedy that was Monday night. The show started off with this, and I'm just so sick of seeing this happen week in and week out on Monday nights. Kurt Angle's having a promo. The promo gets interrupted by Stephanie McMahon. Stephanie McMahon gets interrupted by Roman Reigns.
Competitor A.
Which this week is Roman Reigns.
Right.
And then Roman Reigns gets interrupted by Competitor B, which was Kevin Owens this week. Competitors A and B have a singles match, where competitors C and D, which were Jinder Mahal and Seth Rollins, interfere in said match. And then competitors A and C team up against B and D, heels versus faces, in a tag team match.
Shocking development here on Monday Night Raw.
This was the entire first hour of the show. All of that was the first hour of the show, so I was already just rolling my eyes at that point just because this whole thing was going on, and it just, like I said, this is almost an every week thing that they do on Monday nights, and I'm just so tired of seeing it.
Can I interject and just say, on top of that, one of the main reasons that they did that segment was to try and get Roman over.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah, because when he came out and interrupted Stephanie McMahon, he's still taking the powers that be are against me stance, and it's just falling flat on its face. Oh, sorry. I got a little heated there. But yeah, like I said, that was the entire first hour of the show. There's so much more that you could do. So many competitors that don't get any TV time at all.
Jinder looked great, though.
Jinder looked great. Seth looked great.
Owens looked great.
Roman is Roman.
Right.
Great. But that's just how the show started. Then, oh boy, here we go, guys. A couple weeks ago, Bobby Lashley had a sit-down interview that was pre-recorded with Renee Young, and it just... I mean, I thought that took the winds out of his sails already, but
if that interview
2 weeks ago took the wind out of his sails, this week sank the ship, and now he's just dead in the water. 2 weeks ago, he had a sit down interview where, as Ronnie said, just don't give him the mic. He is physically so intimidating. He can actually go in the ring. He's a lot improved since his first stint in WWE. So you can look at him as like a legitimate badass. He's so big and powerful and quick, and he has a great moveset, I think, for him. But he spent the entire interview kind of talking about giving his backstory, and he mentioned his three sisters and how he's younger than his three sisters, and how he was smaller than them, and they pretty much picked on him, and you know, he was the little guy, and that was like the main part of this interview. So this week, Sami Zayn comes out and interviews his three sisters, and it's three guys.
They're hot.
Three guys in drag. I'll give you this. The one with the mustache was kind of doing it for me.
Hell yeah.
But it's three guys in drag that Sami Zayn dressed up in just makeup, lip gloss, like lipstick, everything, the wigs, the whole nine. And it was a train wreck of a segment with him kind of going to each one and having them relate things that he brought up in that Bobby Lashley brought up in the interview 2 weeks before. And then Lashley comes out and kind of, you know, just has his way with all four men. And these guys were clearly, they were local talent, and it was a train wreck. And God bless Sami Zayn, because he did everything he could with this segment. I have all respect for him and anyone that's in this situation, where I guarantee you, when he found out this was what was going on, he had to hype himself up. He had to tell himself that I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna make, you know, I'm gonna make this into something. And he tried. He tried. But just from concept, this was never something that was gonna work.
Andre, I mean, a lot of questionable things happened in the Attitude Era that certainly wouldn't fly today. And I actually think that this wouldn't have even done well if you take the segment as it was and put it into the Attitude Era. I think even then this falls flat on its face.
Yeah, I agree. It was very uncomfortable.
Cringeworthy.
Cringeworthy, for sure. Probably the worst segment, I don't want to say in Raw history, because... The hand.
I'll put my name in that hat.
Over the hand, the birth of the hand.
That makes me
Bayley's life. Yeah, I got no problem with the hand.
That makes
no,
me
no.
laugh.
The hand is the hand is an important part of wrestling history.
I think
guys.
So. I agree with that.
Okay, I'll give you that. But it's definitely worse than Bayley. This is your life.
Oh my God, so
for
much
sure.
worse.
I'm trying to think if there's any other better, worse than Old Day. I think there was. It just was. There were some people online that were saying that it was even almost homophobic in a way. I
didn't get that.
I didn't either, but
it seemed like it was in poor taste. But
not being part of that community, in a sense, it's kind of like I don't want to speak for them.
Right.
But I don't know. It was very uncomfortable regardless. And to throw on top of that, Lashley coming out and them trying to have Lashley be the smart, talking, happy-go-lucky baby face. Like, oh, shucks, these are my sisters. How very funny when what got him over in TNA was being a badass and
dominating
people up. He should be getting the Brock Lesnar treatment, not in the sense of only showing up once a year, but in the sense of having a mouthpiece, not talking a lot, looking tough and quiet. And the way that they're booking him compared to the way that they're booking Ronda Rousey is worlds different. Yeah, Ronda Rousey's doing some talking. She doesn't have a mouthpiece, but she's not saying more than she needs to. She's saying exactly what she needs to. It fits in with her character. And they just did the opposite with Bobby Lashley. They're trying to make, I don't know if they're trying to make him like the John Cena. I don't know. It's just weird. Have him talking about his sisters. And I don't know. It's bizarre. It's really bizarre when you think about the sit-down interview.
It's not even Goldust.
And then, yeah, not in a good way. And then you think about this segment with his sister. It's just, what good does it do for either of those two competitors, other than maybe Lashley because he beat up some people in drag, if you want to call it that. I don't know if that's disrespectful or PC or not, but beating up some people pretending to be women, and I don't know. It's just weird. Just really uncomfortable, cringeworthy, awkward. Not making Lashley to look that formidable or that tough.
Okay, so in terms of the segment, I think that the drag thing or the LGBTQ community could easily, and maybe they, and I haven't seen enough of the Twitter backlash. I've only seen really from wrestling fans' perspective who hated it anyway. And I think if wrestling fans hate it, then I think that everyone else is going to also find it as extremely distasteful. But I think that when it happened, I was watching, I was like, are they really going this route? Are all three of them women? Or are all three of them guys dressed as women? And I for sure thought that like WWE had made a mistake in 2018. That this thing wouldn't fly, and I know we're only we're 2 days removed from it now, but still I think that and the way the other things have got backlash from fans as well from WWE, whether it be the Greatest Royal Rumble or you know naming the trophy the Moolah trophy or whatever, that this would be in line with those, not quite to the same extent, but that this would also get a lot of bad press from mainstream media or like I said, that those communities that would find this offensive and it was distasteful regardless of what community you're in. Then you look at it as just from a wrestling fan's perspective and how it was just a bad segment. It's been overdone years ago. There's a reason that nobody does this anymore, not just because it is somewhat offensive, but also because it doesn't work and it's so played out. But I will say as you said, I give Sami Zayn a ton of credit. He came out there like this was going to be the best thing ever, and I think he knew that I'm a huge Sami Zayn fan. So a lot of this might be coming from that part of my wrestling fandom that loves Sami Zayn so much. But I don't think that he was bad in the segment at all. I think he played it as well as he could. He came out dancing and skanking, and I think it was great. It sucks that this is what he was forced to do. And who knows? Maybe some things were taken out last second that would have made it better, but it's hard to even think that something would have made it that better. So that's kind of where I'm at with it. But then the Lashley aspect is the worst part about it. That actually made it worse than it was already when he came in and was like just kind of playing along in a funny joke, like, you know, oh yeah, my sisters, of course. Huge mistake giving this man the microphone. Do not do it. Give him a mouthpiece. It's one of the most underused things in WWE today. I think other wrestling companies have figured that out and how you use certain guys. And for whatever reason, WWE, who's supposed to be the top of the totem pole in many ways, does not understand how to use this. I mean, Cesaro should have had a mouthpiece years ago. I know he did for a couple 6 weeks or something with Heyman, but that obviously once Lesnar came back, there was no need. But Lashley has had the best parts of his career have come since, I would say, over the last 3 years, since he's left WWE, right?
Hands down.
And that was a while ago since he's left. But he bored the crap out of me originally, but he really did do a great job these last year with Lucha and TNA?
No, TNA.
Just TNA. He was not in Lucha, but he did have a mouthpiece.
He was in Bellator. He also did MMA, where he actually had a really successful, I can't think of what his record was, but... I'd say he had a successful MMA career.
And didn't he have a mouthpiece in TNA? I thought when I saw him came out that he had at least maybe people or a person with him.
He might have towards the beginning, but towards the end, that's when I got caught up with TNA, like when the grand, like right before the Grand Championship was developed, and not long before he ended up leaving TNA. That's when I saw. But he was on his own then, and he was absolutely holding his own. He kind of like you said, was mentioned with Ronda Rousey, she kind of just says what she needs to say, and that's kind of how he was in TNA. He would go out, he would say what he needed to say. He had his world title over his shoulder, and it was believable.
Yeah, and they have to do some like a reclamation project now after that, and in the last few weeks, my prediction for Bobby Lashley is that he will be in Titus Worldwide by SummerSlam. That's where I think he goes. And actually, I think a tag team of him and Apollo. It's not Apollo Crews anymore. It's just Apollo. I think that would be an awesome tag team. But I think this last couple weeks, especially Monday Night, really hurt him and put him behind the eight ball.
A couple weeks ago, they started calling him Apollo Crews. I don't know if it stuck, but they did call him Apollo Crews a couple times a couple weeks ago, which is really confusing. I just wanted to point that out.
Yeah.
I hope they don't do that. I could definitely see WWE doing something like that.
Unfortunately.
I don't want to see it. He's not done. They can still fix this.
I don't know, man. Honestly, that's just how I feel about this segment. After this week, I feel like especially with the interview itself, the original interview with Renee Young, that did no favors for him either, and this is just further digging that ditch. This man had a 15-2 MMA record. He only lost twice. He's legitimate. You put him, like you said, Fron, you put him on that same level with Brock Lesnar. You put him on the same level as a Ronda Rousey, where they have they bring up the fact that their MMA success, and they legitimize them through that with those two. Why are you not doing that with Bobby Lashley? Why are his three sisters the main talking point when it comes to Bobby Lashley right now in 2018, now that he's back in WWE?
Probably trying to give him some character, something that people can get behind, but it's not working. Right, I don't know if you guys remember right before that sit-down interview with Renee Young, they had a video package about Bobby Lashley's past and his road back to WWE. That video package was great. That's the kind of stuff they need to do with him, because it highlights his strengths. He didn't have to really talk much. But then they had that interview, and then they had this... wow, it's... He can be reclaimed, but it's frustrating because of how the potential they have with him. Because look at his physique, look at his MMA record. Dang, shame, shame.
In New Orleans, when I was there, it was like, okay, he came back, and that was kind of like, interesting. I know there was a lot of speculation about it, but I didn't see a need for WWE to have him on Monday Night Raw. And not to say they can't find a good spot for him, but to me, this is very much, we got you. We wanted that pop after, people coming back on the Raw after Mania.
And now we have nothing for you.
And it was kind of, I think now the idea is, okay, Sammy and Lashley aren't going to be in the Money in the Bank, so we'll just put these guys together for now. So I really do think that they signed him with little to no plan, and that's part of why we're seeing what we saw on Monday Night.
Yeah, hopefully, if that is the case, what you just mentioned, the fact that this is neither of them are in the Money in the Bank ladder match, they'll most likely have. I think it might even already happen, but I'm pretty sure they'll probably have a match if it's not already been announced.
Oh, I'm sure.
And then hopefully we can move on from this and try to build Bobby Lashley as the destroyer, the dominator that he is.
There's only one explanation for all of this. WWE secretly hired Vince Russo back.
Jeez. Oh, my God.
And now we're going to have a Lashley sister on a pole match.
Bro. It's Armageddon. It's Ragnarok.
Right hand to God. Right hand to God. We got to get Lashley.
it's all of that. That was a good Russo.
He always says that. I don't know why.
Bro. Yeah.
All right. So moving on from this terrible segment, just to kind of finish this up
abortion
with
abortion of a
yeah. Gosh, I wish someone would have aborted this segment. Just to finish up with things that happened on Raw, there was a contract signing between Nia Jax and Ronda Rousey for the Raw Women's Championship at Money in the Bank, and I didn't hate this segment. I thought that. These are the kind of segments that Ronda, you can tell she's kind of cutting her teeth in the business, mm-hmm. and I don't think that she did a bad job with it, and I don't think Nia did a terrible job either. I know a lot of people are kind of, just from reactions on social media, kind of fed up with having contract signings on Monday Night Raw, but for Ronda Rousey, I think this was really, really good for her. It's kind of putting her through the motions of what's expected of a WWE superstar, and she's not doing a bad job.
Yeah, so my take on this was, it's not a bad segment. It's an overdone thing.
Yes.
The contract signings should have been done a long time ago. This one was not horrible, and contract signings, while they have been very much overdone, if you're going to do them, it makes the most sense to do it with someone like a Ronda Rousey or in a title picture. And I know that is mostly the case, but you don't always have the Lashleys, the Lesnars, and the Rouseys or the Baszlers. I think those are the people who do have are legit badasses, the Ken Shamrocks, whoever, Dan the Beast Severn. Those are the guys that you do the fun contract signings with. It needs to be few and far between leading up to a big four or five pay-per-view. So if you really take it at that, this isn't that bad. But when you add in that we've seen the contract signing so many times, that's why I think it was overplayed for a lot of fans. But I don't think people thought – I wouldn't blame them for this. I think it was just lazy writing that we've seen this over and over again. But once again, this is the kind of scenario that you want to see the contract signing is between a big fighter and the champion and someone who was a legit fighter and badass in fighting for the championship, who's also learning her way in WWE. So I have no problem with this segment. It's just the writing team and Vince McMahon doing this over and over again when it doesn't need to be done. But this was a good spot for it.
I agree with you. I just want to jump in and say I agree with you that it is overdone. But in my eyes, I've just kind of had this thought as you're mentioning it, especially when you brought up the fact that if you have someone like a Ronda Rousey that has that legit background, I feel like there is a place for this still in today's wrestling, today's product, because it's like it's the same thing to me. I look at it as it's the same thing as with a big time boxing match or a big time MMA match. It's like the weigh-in, you know. And
I was just gonna say, you think with the Alexa Bliss thing that they probably wanted to avoid that with Nia Jax?
Oh, jeez. I just walked into that one.
I was gonna say it. If you didn't, that's where I was going. No, I know. I had to, and I told him that I wanted to get in for this for that particular reason. And then you dropped a weigh-in on me anyway,
and
so
I set you up.
Yeah,
perfectly for it.
It was a softball.
Damn it.
Speaking of weigh-ins, and contract signings.
That's how I look at it. It's just you know, it has the same hype around it as a weigh-in does, especially with UFC weigh-ins nowadays, where you have Conor McGregor throwing
boners. What
did he throw? Like a like hand dolly cart through the window of the bus.
Yeah.
You know, it gives a chance to put more eyes on it. So,
yeah. Speaking of contract signings and weigh-ins and all that kind of thing, yes, they are overdone. But this one did what it needed to do. It was slightly different because no one was put through the table for once, or were they? Did I?
No, the table just got thrown out of the way.
Okay. Yep. That's cool. Off. And number two, it finally put some tension between the two baby faces. And got some real, I don't want to say heat, but like, they obviously they like each other because it's all fake, or it's all an act. It's not fake, it's kayfabe. But they had some real, there's some stakes involved now. You saw a little bit of both of their egos creep up, which is really good. But speaking of weigh-ins, one thing I think they need to change with these contract signings, and I think would give it a breath of fresh air, and it's probably been brought up on the show by all three of us at some point, but it's to do more of a backstage thing. I think that would be a lot of fun if you do it like a weigh-in where you have... Maybe have Vince and
like have the segment be backstage.
Release a video of it from earlier in the day or something, and then also have their like crew and posse with them. I think that actually makes it more fun too.
And you know, kind of separated when they go at each other. And you know, have Vince and the two GMs.
It would be cool if they did that like from the WWE studios, like, or, you know, obviously it doesn't have to be from right. WWE studios, but say that, you know, show a shot of WWE studios and then have it fade into yeah. the contract signing where it's earlier, where, like you said, you have the GM and the commissioner, you have Vince McMahon, you have the, you know, the two of them face to face, kind of like how the contract signing went down for Hogan and Andre at Mania, you know, like have it be that kind of, they're across the table from each other, that type, you know, that I think that would be better than the kind of contract signings that we have now, which is in-ring segment.
You know what I was kind of thinking too, what comes to my mind when I think of a backstage thing, which that's a really great idea too, I didn't think about the Andre and Hogan, but was WrestleMania 14 Michaels and Austin with Mike Tyson, like that kind of setup.
Okay, that works. Yeah, that works too, where it's like they're a panel kind of. Yeah,
especially
yeah, I want to see that.
Ronda.
Yes.
Another reason why I think this particular contract signing was okay, and I agree with everything that you guys have said about how to make it more fun and more like boxing or MMA, but that because this rivalry story sort of started off on like a red carpet interview with where Nia interrupts Ronda Rousey, and I don't know if she actually knew that was coming or not. But then just to like realize it and actualize it on television, I think that it was this was an okay route this time. I think WWE still should get shame for doing the contract signings too often and not finishing their wings. But they but that this one actually was well placed, and it had good psychology as to why you would do it with these two wrestlers and why in this situation with these two. So. No
and,
issues
and
there.
Stephanie was fun. Poking,
Stephanie was a great. Was a great part about it. That was one of my favorite parts. Yeah, yep. That was one of the better parts of Raw as a whole.
I mean, you could even say that the tension that we saw between them two was because of Stephanie and what she said to both of them. So that was that segment worked in my eyes. A couple other highlights. Chad Gable and Dolph Ziggler had a fantastic match, and Dolph Ziggler got the win. And then after the win, he got the win with the super kick. After the win, Drew McIntyre, I almost said Galloway. Drew McIntyre comes in and hits a Claymore kick, and I'm just loving everything that they're doing with these two and the stance that they said it multiple times during the match that these two think that the WWE roster as a whole has gone soft and they're here to claim the top spot, this, that, and the other. I love the attitude and them taking that route with these two. Natalya qualified for the women's Money in the Bank ladder match. She defeated Dana Brooke and Sarah Logan. Gosh, having a hard time remembering names. And the main event was Finn Balor versus Braun Strowman, which was just a fantastic match. You have the David versus Goliath matchup, and they're both just at the top of their game right now. And that match was awesome.
Yeah, I really like. The Lashley sisters thing was such a weird thing that it was hard to maybe fully recover from it. But there were parts about Raw that weren't
awful.
Things
here and
there's parts to be interested about, and it's not like we're gonna see. I hope that we don't see the Lashley sisters next week, but you never know.
But yeah, just as a whole 3-hour show, it was hard to get through, and I know especially recently a lot of people online and social media and whatnot have not really had the highest opinion of Raw. And I a lot of episodes that people say are terrible or trash, I don't feel that way. I feel like there's more good than bad. But this week there was hardly any good, and in my eyes, almost all bad.
Mm-hmm. I do want to say the segment and then the match with Braun Strowman and Finn Balor was great. Finn Balor, he lost the match, but he did a really good job of putting some doubt in my mind as to whether or not, oh, maybe he can win via countout or something like that. I know that they're not going to have Strowman take a pin, but yeah, I think that was a great match too.
Yeah, that was. I really liked the way that they made it believable that Finn Balor could win the match, but ultimately he ended up losing to Braun Strowman. All right, I think that wraps it up for us this week. Thanks for listening here at 103.5, the Sun Community Radio Station. You can find us on social media at the Schmozcast on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and get caught up on demand on YouTube. Just search the Schmozcast. And yeah, that'll do it for us. For Andre and Anthony, I'm Chandler. Thanks for listening.
Shout out to Matthew Jeffco.